when they get symptoms and we start them aggressively on antibiotics, and it's going to be for a, you know, a minimum of a month, and we're going to treat them until their symptoms are well gone.
People often on long-term antibiotics that they sometimes have their symptoms feeling worse straight away, or that during the treatment they have these flares of symptoms. Can you explain what the mechanism is behind that?
Well, I think there is a group of patients that will present that have a, number one, they'll have an infection in their bladder, in the urine, in the biofilm, that, and then also in the bladder cells. And some of these patients that have not been treated, when you give them antibiotics, you have a massive kill.
Mm-hmm.
And when bacteria die, they basically explode. Their little guts and stuff go everywhere. Well, those are their guts. Their insides of the bacteria are essentially proteins. And that's how the body reacts. That causes an inflammatory response. The body sees those foreign proteins. It sends in white blood cells. There's an immune response, and an immune response is associated with pain.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the so-called die-off symptoms that can develop. And I think there's another group of patients that they develop flares. A lot of times flares are associated with intercourse.
Mm-hmm.
And what happens during intercourse? Well, the lining of the bladder becomes disrupted. There's a release of bacteria into the urine. Some of those bacteria, if they're not killed by antibiotics, will create a rapid replication and essentially an acute UTI until the antibiotics can get it under control again.
Okay. We have a question about self-caffeine and neurogenic bladder. Is an approach like yours with the long-term antibiotic treatment suitable for people in that situation?
There are patients that have neurogenic bladders from either diabetes or from spinal cord injuries that have trouble with recurrent urinary tract infections. And many times the same mechanism that we've been discussing today is responsible. They no longer have acute infections. They have a chronic infection.
Mm-hmm.
So there are patients that develop this that I'll do exactly the same thing. And they'll notice considerable improvement. Their bladder capacity will go up. Their leakage will go down. Their bladder becomes more compliant, has more capacity. So yes, there's a role for it.
Are they at risk of future infections or more at risk because they have to self-cath?
Well, anytime your bladder does not empty when it's supposed to, or empty completely when it's supposed to, that's a risk for infection.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's why diabetic patients, even though they have high concentrations of sugar in their urine and they're immunosuppressed because of their diabetes, people that don't empty their bladder completely, that's generally the source for infection. The urine essentially becomes stagnant.
Speaking of the patients that do recover on this protocol, if they do experience a relapse later, what action should they take at that time?
All my patients are instructed.
Mm-hmm.
Always have a microgen test available for you to use. When they get symptoms, they produce the specimen, and we start them aggressively on antibiotics. And it's going to be for a minimum of a month, and we're going to treat them until their symptoms are well gone, or they'll be right back where they were.
Okay, sure. What about people that have or are prone to bacterial vaginosis or yeast infection? Do you proactively kind of treat that when they go on antibiotics?
Well, I almost everyone leaves with a prescription for Diflucan to treat yeast. I know very little about bacterial vaginosis. I don't really have any training in there. And so that's definitely a weak spot for me.
Okay.
So if people have symptoms of bacterial vaginosis, then I suggest that they're treated by their gynecologist. That's not my area of expertise.
Okay, sure. And when it comes to managing the pain while you're on treatment, what are your recommendations there?
Well, the first thing is non-steroidals, non-steroidal anti-inflammatories. That's kind of the mainstay for me. But we've had to use other things, Neurontin, you know, gabapentin, anything to provide some relief until the antibiotics can do their job.
Yeah, I think that's really important. So for people that are experiencing their first UTI ever or their first recurrence, what do you recommend they do to prevent it from becoming chronic? I think they typically get a 3 or 5 day course of antibiotics, but is that enough?
That's a mistake.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the role for 3 day course of antibiotics is about 30 years old. And I think that almost everyone should have a minimum of 2 weeks of antibiotics now.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody is a patient of mine that had a recurrence after experiencing a long period of chronic bacterial cystitis, it would be a minimum of a month.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, so that's quite a bit.
One of the things that we have to do, I think, is repeat these UTI studies, these drug studies, and follow them longer.
Yeah.
Because what those studies showed is that patients, yeah, they got relief and then a month later they were okay. But 3 months later, they were right back where they were. So
absolutely.
What they didn't understand is those medications failed.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Those studies need to be done again.
Yeah, I agree. We hear from people all the time that have recurrences in a time frame longer than would have been tracked. And I think that's part of the problem. Nobody's followed up to see what the real experience is.
Absolutely.
You mentioned briefly IC and the fact that it may be infection for a lot of people. Is your patient base, I mean, how many people do you treat that were previously diagnosed with IC?
A lot.
And do you see those people respond in the same way as people that were not diagnosed with IC?
Yes.
What about in the case of Hunter's ulcers in the bladder? Do you find that people with those also respond to treatment?
Of course. Yeah, you know, Hunter, you can create Hunter's ulcers in the bladder. And people, if you fill their bladder up enough and they're asleep, their bladder will crack. I assure you. You know, I do procedures for other urologic problems, and their bladder's over-distended for a period of time, and you can look in there and you can see those same same things. You know, so, you know, that's just that was a phenomenon that was identified. And it's irrelevant now.
Do you ever biopsy those ulcers to see what infection is present there, or do you mostly rely on the symptoms and the other testing that you use?
Well, several years ago, I did testing with Microgen, where I did the urine DNA and I took the patients to surgery, and essentially you're trying to create a tissue culture.
Mm-hmm.
So we would biopsy the bladder and send it off, and they would morselate it and identify the bacteria that were present. And it turned out to be pretty disappointing.
Okay.
As far as results. So I thought that would be essentially the holy grail, right, of this condition. And I was wrong.
Does that mean you weren't finding organisms there at all, or just not what you were expecting?
Negative.
Okay.
No, nothing.
Right.